Welcome everyone to my mini review of Intel's newest graphics card, the first to launch in the new Battle Mage series, their second generation of Arc GPUs. This is the B580. It has 12 gigs of VRAM, it has a $250 MSRP, and this video is going to be a lot about the B580, but it's also going to be a lot about Nvidia's RTX 4060, because this GPU is not that great, and honestly, you all deserve something better.
Excellent!
Today's video is brought to you by Thermaltake's The Tower 600 series cases, continuing their popular lineup of vertical body design solutions with more room than ever for high-end PC builds. With support for full-size ATX motherboards with hidden connectors, side radiator mounts with room for 360 and 420mm AIOs, a dual-mode GPU mounting system, and vented side panels that easily pop off for access to cable management or the 13 fan mounts, the Tower 600 is both easy to build in and distinct in its design. There's an optional display stand and LCD panel too. For more on the Tower 600 series cases from Thermaltake, click the sponsor link in the video description. So I'm calling this a mini review because I just have a handful of benchmarks to share. I focused on 1440 gaming and I only compared to the RTX 4060 from Nvidia. And that's because also going on this week is our Extra Life charity stream, which I have a lot of prepping and planning to do for. That's happening on Saturday. So if you weren't already aware, maybe stop by and help us raise some money for Children's Miracle Network hospitals. In the meantime, the Arc B580 is a pretty impressive card when it comes to the specs. It's using Intel's BMG G21 SoC, second generation Xe architecture, which is the code name Intel uses for all of their Arc GPUs. But when it comes to the specs, the thing I most want to point out is the VRAM allocation. We have 12 gigabytes of GDDR6 on a 192-bit bus with this graphics card, and that is one of the severest limitations of the RTX 4060. Only 8 gigs of VRAM on a 128-bit bus, and especially if you're playing at higher resolutions like 1440, and also if you're turning on lots of eye candy, in particular ray tracing, that VRAM buffer can be used up quickly, and once it runs out, performance really drops off. Apart from those specs, here's a closer look at this specific card I'm testing today, which is Intel's Signature Edition Arc B580, which has a nice soft finish on the outside, a two-fan cooler, stays with two-slot spacing, which is nice, and it actually features a blow-through design, which is similar to Nvidia's Founders Edition graphics cards. On the back, we have four video outs. Three of them are DisplayPort 2.1 that can handle resolutions up to 7680 by 4320 at 60 Hertz. And note that one of them is labeled as the primary DisplayPort out. Then we also have an HDMI 2.1A out that can do 7680 by 4320 at up to 120 Hertz. For supplemental power, we have a standard 8-pin PCI Express graphics connector, and you'll be seeing reviews today for this card, but tomorrow you should see a bunch of other reviews come out for third-party cards featuring different designs from this from add-in board partners like ASRock. And now let's jump into the benchmarks. We're going to start with a couple synthetics because they're quick and easy. This is 3D Mark TimeSpy Extreme, which is a DirectX 12 test that runs at 4K, and here we can see a pretty impressive lead by the Arc B580, about 43% faster in terms of the graphics score than Nvidia's RTX 4080 8GB, but this is of course a synthetic test, so we'll see if this lead bears out in the actual game testing. We have one more synthetic, that's 3D Mark Port Royal, that has a focus on ray tracing, which is traditionally an area where Nvidia excels. However, the B580 won in this test, scoring 7,879, that's a 28.5% lead over the RTX 4060. Did I mention that this card costs $300, whereas Intel's new card costs $250? Our next test is Shadow of the Tomb Raider. We're running at 2560 by 1440, but I did test it three different ways, with super sampling, aka DLSS on the Nvidia side or XESS on the Intel side, turned off, as well as with it enabled in balanced mode, and then turning it up to performance mode. With no DLSS, the B580 had 143.3 average frames per second, 25.9% faster than the 4060 8GB. If we switch super sampling on, DLSS for Nvidia, XESS for the Intel card, in balanced mode, we can see that Nvidia gets more of a boost here than Intel, and it actually manages to outperform the B580, 164.4 FPS to 160.5, leaving the B580 about 3.5% behind. When we switch to DLSS and XESS performance mode, which is going to sacrifice a little bit more image quality for higher frame rates, the Nvidia card pulls ahead even more to 218.2 average FPS to the B580's 173.9, putting the Intel card about 20% behind. Now, I should point out that I'm just focused on frame rates here. I'm not actually doing image quality comparison, so the Nvidia card in this situation is giving up a little bit more image quality relative to the Intel card, but this is an area where Intel still has a little bit of catching up to do. In particular, if you look at the 1% lows here, you can see that Nvidia gets gains as you enable DLSS at more advanced levels, whereas Intel stays a little bit more flat, only going from 105 FPS to about 115. Our next game is Cyberpunk 2077, and again, I tested three ways at 1440 with no DLSS or XeSS, and then in quality mode and performance mode. Without the aid of super sampling, the B580 hit 71.3 frames per second, about 24.9% faster than the 4060, and it managed to maintain the lead with DLSS and XeSS quality mode turned on, hitting 102.5 average frames per second, staying about 13% ahead of the Nvidia card. And then when we switch over to performance mode, the cards are pretty much neck and neck, about 121 average frames per second, although the 4060 is giving us slightly more consistent frame times with the 1% lows at 88.4 FPS. Next up, we have F1 2024, and this game actually had an early build that reviewers were able to access that allowed us to turn on frame generation, which is a brand new feature for XeSS 2. Frame generation is something that Nvidia and AMD both already have. It is sometimes viewed with skepticism because it can add a little bit of latency, so it's much more useful if you're playing single player games than multiplayer, for example, but it's now a feature that Intel has too, first to debut in F1 2024. So starting off without any super sampling or anything turned on, we're at 54.3 FPS for the B580, that's 16% faster than the 4060 8GB, although the 1% lows are lagging behind a little bit, and that is still a bit of a concern. Intel does need to catch up and polish its drivers a little bit to bring those 1% lows up and give us more consistent frame times. Turning on DLSS for Nvidia and XeSS for Intel gave us 89.5 average frames per second from the B580, which is 13.7% faster than the 4060's 78.7 average FPS. However, frame time consistency is still an issue with Intel. 44.7 on the 1% lows is pretty far behind the 4060. And then we have our frame generation test as well, where we got a really nice boost in terms of averages, going from about 90 FPS to 148 with the B580 and frame generation turned on. Again, with the limited amount of time I had to put this video together, I did not do side-by-side comparisons between the image quality, but I can say anecdotally, while watching the test run with frame generation turned on the Intel card, I didn't notice any glaring artifacting or image quality aberrations that stood out to me. Perhaps going over it again in slow motion or frame by frame would reveal more there, but again, we are suffering on the 1% lows side with the B580 only at 57.2 versus the 4060's 89.7. Rounding things out with a couple more games, we have Horizon Zero Dawn Remastered at 1440. Here the B580 got 69.3 average frames per second, 22% faster than the 4060's 56.8, and our 1% lows were also staying pretty consistent here at 52.9. And then there was Starfield, where Nvidia wins. And this is an area where Intel has actually had some difficulty in the past as well. But Starfield is a popular game, and this just goes to show that while Intel has made a lot of gains in a lot of different areas, but there are still games where Intel lags behind, and this is definitely one of them. It's about 10% slower than the 4060 8GB. And that rounds out my testing. I know it was more limited than what I usually do, but I was very short on time this week, so I'm glad that I was able to produce anything. The upshot, I think, is that Intel has a very competitively priced card here in the B580 that can offer significant performance gains over what Intel is selling for $300 compared to $250. I think there's two possible outcomes of this card launching. One is that consumers love it and they scoop it up, and I think that's a possibility. I think there's a big market out there for sub $300 cards. People have been waiting for a while for a new card to come out that offers a significant performance improvement. And I will also say that Intel, this time around, since it's the second generation of their graphics cards with Battle Mage versus Alchemist that came out last year, it is a better experience. It's more polished. It's providing more stable performance across a wider range of games than their first generation did for sure, but it's still not completely out of the woods in terms of development of the drivers, as well as I'd say particularly looking at those 1% lows, frame time consistency is important to gamers out there, but that is again hopefully something that they can continue to improve with driver updates. The second outcome that I think is slightly more likely and that I'm hoping for is that Nvidia looks at this graphics card and looks at the consumer response and compares it against the 4060, which is still a bad card, which doesn't have enough VRAM, that Nvidia has just clearly positioned to be this mediocre offering at $300 to encourage people to spend more money on their higher end graphics cards. But not everyone's got unlimited money, Budget gamers need an option too, and I hope that the B580 becomes that. This also gives me a lot of hope and anticipation for presumably the 700 series class of cards that Intel still has waiting in the wings. There's a B570 that's gonna be launching January 16th, and hopefully we'll hear maybe about 700 series cards at CES as well in January. The biggest impact I hope the B580 has is to make Nvidia seriously consider the pricing and positioning of their 50 series cards that are coming out in Q1, and that they will offer something at the $300 price that's like a good card that we can recommend and say, hey, this isn't like the 4060 that just sucks in so many different ways. You know, get it in Nvidia's new 5060 or whatever they call it, or get the B580 because Intel has continued to improve their drivers and it's actually a valuable card. It can even do AI. They have an AI demo set up that does stable diffusion that you can just load up and use. It's got a large language model in there as well. So that's another reason why a higher VRAM buffer is very helpful. But I think I've said enough for this video. I will post links to this video card down in the description. Thank you guys so much for watching. Check out my store on your way out if you want to, paulshardware.net. Hit the thumbs up button if you enjoyed this video. Subscribe to my channel if you haven't already for more videos coming at you soon. We will see you hopefully on Saturday during our live stream. Thanks again for watching and have a fantastic day.